This morning, I want us to be encouraged by the reality that Jesus shows up. But I also want us to see that that's not something new. Jesus shows up all the time. God shows up in our lives, and he especially does that in those times when we're uncertain of his presence. Let's look at Ezekiel. In Ezekiel, we have this prophecy. God comes to Ezekiel and he takes him out into the desert and he looks across this desert. This desert, the place where many, many battles over the years have happened and where many, many people have died. And he looks out and he sees the dry desert and he sees the dry bones. And God asks Ezekiel, can these bones live? Do you have hope? Do you see possibility? Now, Ezekiel was very sharp at this point because what Ezekiel said was, God, you know. I don't pretend to know. I'm trusting you to know. And then God asks Ezekiel to prophesy to the bones. Now, one of the other interesting things in this text is as those bones come together, they don't live yet. Somehow they come together in the form of a body and all the sinew and flesh comes upon them. But then they still don't breathe. And so then God says to Ezekiel, this time prophesy not to the bones, but to the breath, to the wind, to the spirit. And say, breath, give these bones life. That's a powerful, powerful prophecy. But the interesting thing is, it's not really about the prophecy. You see, what God is doing is responding to the people of Israel. They've said of themselves, we have dry bones. They've said of themselves that we are without hope. And so God sends Ezekiel to do this prophetic work to illustrate for the people of Israel that God has the power to restore, that God has the power to resurrect and redeem, especially in places that are least filled with hope. And then he asks Ezekiel to prophesy directly to them so that they know God's word is for them. He will lift them up. He will give them new life in the midst of their despair. That is the promise of God for his people. That is the heart of God for his people. And so, you and I, in the midst of concerns and darkness and even death and grief, we need to understand that God has the power to give us new life, a new tomorrow, a renewed hope as we put our trust in him. Then there's the story of Lazarus in our gospel lesson this morning. There's a couple of things about this text that it's important to realize. The first is that Jesus has just recently left Jerusalem when the leaders had planned to stone him to death. So he had literally left to save his own life. And then this word comes, and it comes from the home where Jesus resides when he comes into Jerusalem. These are among Jesus' best friends. This is his spiritual family that is now reaching out to him. Lord, he whom you love is ill. And listen to these words. Now, Jesus loved Martha, her sister, and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. What kind of reaction is that? Someone you love calls on the phone. Don't you like hang up and go get in the car and go to them? It almost doesn't make any sense. You almost want to say, but when Jesus heard this, he waited 2 more days. We need to recognize that our timing is not always God's timing. That things that seem so incredibly urgent to us are not necessarily urgent to God. God's ways are not our ways. God's timing is not our timing. What do you suppose happened in the heart of Mary and Martha over those 2 days? Do you suppose they were sitting on the edge of their seat, waiting to hear word that Jesus was coming into town? Do you suppose that they began to lose hope? Well, the truth is, none of that was happening. Their brother, who was sick, died. They were burying Lazarus while Jesus was waiting. For when Jesus finally came, we learn that Lazarus was in the tomb for 4 days. They were not happy with Jesus. So both Martha, you'll remember the story of Martha, who was the one that was so busy, she was working when Jesus was in the house and complained about her sister Mary, who was sitting at Jesus' feet. Martha is the get-it-done person. And so when Martha hears that Jesus is coming, she rushes out to meet him, and she has a word for him. Her word was, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." But oddly enough, Martha still has hope. She continues to say, "But I know that whatever you ask of God, he will do." Martha thinks that Jesus needed to be there, but she also thinks that Jesus still has power. Yet, when Jesus says he has power to raise the dead, Martha's still challenging. She's like, yeah. I know at the end of life, he'll raise from the dead and go to heaven with the rest of us. And Jesus said, no. You need to understand something, Martha. You need to remember who I am. I am the resurrection and the life. I believe that Martha received an influx of amazing hope at this point. And as they sat there, she said, "I got to tell Mary." So Martha runs home to Mary, who's still sitting at home, probably mourning, probably in tears and in heartbreak. And immediately she hears from Martha and runs out to see Jesus. And she has the same accusation. "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Now, I want us to hear that accusation for our own lives. Because so often, we may not be saying, "If you had been here, someone I love wouldn't have died," but essentially we're saying, "God, when you don't meet my timing, I'm disappointed." And it's as if hope has died. There's no chance anymore. When it didn't happen, when I thought it should happen, it's over. I give up. And I think what God is saying to us, this message of this text is, don't give up. And I want you to remember, too, that this is a prelude for what's happening. Jesus has indeed come to Jerusalem to die. This is the beginning of Jesus heading toward his own crucifixion and death. For many, they thought that was the end of the movement. They thought that their hope in the possibility that maybe, in fact, Jesus was the Messiah, was gone. But even in the midst of his own death, God brings resurrection. God brings hope, a hope in which we can still stand, a hope in which we can still have confidence. Keep the faith. The most amazing things that happen in life tend to happen right at that moment when we're about, or maybe even the moment after, we've given up. God does not give up on us. And therefore, we can, even in the midst of isolation, even in the midst of confusion, even in the midst of worrying about what the future may hold, we can and are his children and be a people of hope. Then we hear the second lesson read for today, the Romans 8 lesson, that great word that there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. But do you remember where that comes from in Romans 8? Do you remember Romans 7? Romans 7 is where the Apostle Paul, of all people, seems to say, I'm just lost. The things, the good things I want to do, I don't do them. The bad things that I don't want to do, those are the very things I do. And then as he's coming to the end of chapter 7, he says, I see in my body another law waging war against the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin. This sounds a lot like, it's just who I am. I can't help it. I'm just lost. Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me? See, when we're in the midst of that hopeless place, when we think we're out of control and there's nothing we can do, we seem to ask the question, if I can't save myself, there's nothing I can do. I want to go back to Ezekiel for a moment, because I think sometimes we are a little proud of ourselves. Sometimes we think that we are dry bones. We acknowledge our brokenness, and then we think, you know what? I can pull myself back together. Let me work at this. I can mend myself up. I can improve my life. I can make better decisions. I can develop better habits. I can make life better for myself. But God controls resurrection, power, and life. God's the one that brings the breath of his Spirit, the presence of his indwelling Holy Spirit into our lives to empower us to live out of his grace. It's not out of effort. Instead, it's out of submission, not in trusting in myself or trying to work harder, but literally in trusting in God to bring love into my life and out of my life into the lives of others. This power that raised Jesus from the dead is at work in us. My favorite verse of all times is from Ephesians. Ephesians 3, 14 to 1, Paul prays this amazing prayer of the indwelling power of his Spirit, of the depths of his love. And then he says, and the one at work in us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can think or imagine, in Jesus Christ and in the church. God isn't finished. His timing may not be our timing, but we can be a people of hope because God's Spirit indwells us. God is at work in us. He is able to accomplish in and through us more than we can ever ask or imagine. And so let's remember the depth of God's love for us. Let's remember that as long as we have God, we have hope. God is with us in these days. There are a number of people around us, and maybe even we feel discouraged. But to our discouragement, God says to us, bones come together. God says to us, people who are without hope, trust in me, believe in me, have hope. I love you, and you are mine. Thanks be to God.